Good morning, everyone. Today is February 27th at 7:44 in the morning here in the United States. You know, with this COVID-19 epidemic, but in my mind, this is a pandemic now, which is likely to be cleared an official pandemic in the upcoming days. I do want to talk about, you know, what we can do, what we should do moving forward, both as a country, as a world, and as individuals. With COVID-19 becoming a pandemic, even though it's not official at this moment, we have to strike a balance between overreacting, being fearful, versus being prepared. And I think that's a fine line, but I think together, as people, both as individuals, as a society as a whole, as a country, and even on a global scale, we have to be very prepared for what's going on. And so that's what I'm going to talk about in this video. I also want to answer a lot of questions that people are having that are leaving in the comment section of my previous videos. So I hope to get to as many of those as I can in this one. If I can't get to them today in this one, I hope to get to it in the next one. With this pandemic and with any pandemic really in the beginning phases, it's hard to know what to do a lot of times because everything is so new. Everyone is learning about it. Both the public is learning about it pretty much at the same pace as the professionals are learning about it, all the experts, all the epidemiologists, all the physicians. All of this is a learning process in real time, and everything is being done in terms of the studies as fast as possible, studying the medicine, studying the vaccines, and I'll get to that in a little bit. Because we're in the beginning phases of the pandemic, there's still a lot of unanswered questions, such as, can you become reinfected with this coronavirus? How long is the incubation period? What is the case fatality rate? How many people are infected without having symptoms? In Wuhan, China, the reported CFR is around 3%. Many expert epidemiologists believe that to be an overestimate because many patients weren't tested, many infected people don't have symptoms, and hospitals were overwhelmed. The CFR is more likely 1%, and this seems to correlate with the cases outside of China. Outside of China, confirmed cases divided by number of deaths outside of China, based on these numbers, is around 1.5%. Now some say, well, the number of people infected, some of those people will die, so those numbers aren't accurate. And that's true, but so will the numbers of missed cases as well. Only time will tell the true CFR, but it's important to calculate what that number is the best that we can, because the number will have implications in preparing for the pandemic. The worse the pandemic, the more drastic measures that will have to be taken. And the severity of the pandemic is mainly determined by the CFR, the number of critically ill patients, and the number of deaths. The more severe the pandemic, the more school closings, the more limitations on public gatherings and social contact. The less severe the pandemic, the less sense it makes to make such drastic actions because of the impact it will have on social and economic stability. Regardless of the amount of drastic action that we have to take as a society, there are lots of simple things that we can do to drastically minimize the spread of the disease. These simple things make a big difference, so the more people do these things, the less severe the pandemic will be. These simple things include washing hands frequently, especially after touching something, not touching your face without having just washed them, avoiding people who are sick, if we're sick, staying home or wearing a mask when we go out, covering a cough with the inner elbow. We touch our face, including nose, eyes, and mouth, an average of 20 times per hour every day. And usually this is done subconsciously. We're not even aware that we're doing it. We also touch money, door handles, handrails, menus, and 1,000 other objects. We sometimes inhale tiny droplets that come from someone sneezing or coughing nearby. So the best advice that I can give, and this is what my mom asked me yesterday when she called me, is to do this, is to be intentional with your hand hygiene. This means keeping your hands clean and especially don't touch your face without clean hands. When washing your hands, the most common areas that are missed are actually the thumbs, in between the fingers, and on the wrists. So sing happy birthday about 20 seconds when you're washing your hands and make sure you cover all the areas, wash them good, and especially don't touch your face without having clean hands. So being a pulmonary and critical care physician, my risk of getting a respiratory illness is slightly higher than someone who's not in the healthcare field. But the same techniques that I do are the same things that you can do, and that really means hand hygiene. Now, on occasion, depending on the circumstances, I have to wear personal protective equipment. Again, it all depends on the patient that I'm seeing. But other than that, there's really no difference in terms of hand washing and having good hand hygiene. Whether or not you need to wear a mask, it really depends on the circumstances. And I made a whole video dedicated to answering this question called "Should You Wear a Mask?" There will probably be a shortage of medical masks, and we need to make sure healthcare workers have enough. And same goes for household members caring for sick relatives and people who are ill and need to go outside. In a severe pandemic, there wouldn't be enough ventilators to support patients breathing. Health facilities will need to prepare for a worst-case scenario by anticipating a surge in COVID-19 patients who become critically ill. If underprepared for a pandemic, that can lead to more people dying from other diseases due to disruptions of day-to-day healthcare. This is all the more reason why people with chronic conditions should receive 3 months of prescription medications whenever possible, and also why it's so important to get appropriate vaccinations depending on individual circumstances. This includes things like influenza vaccination, and depending on the person's age and other medical conditions, the pneumococcal vaccination. Now I want to get to some of the questions that you had, so let's go ahead and get started. One of them is regarding vaccine. Actually, there's a vaccine that was just, well, created, but still needs further study. So it's going to go into investigative trials in April, and because it needs to go in these trials to determine how safe it is and how effective it is, it's probably going to be a year before the vaccine is ready. Now, this vaccine is special because it's actually groundbreaking. It's never been done before, this type of vaccine. So normally when a vaccine is made, let's draw a virus. All right. So a virus is a very simple structure compared to everything else in biology. It has an outer shell, a capsid outer shell made out of protein. And inside, depending on what kind of virus it is, it's either going to be DNA or RNA. The coronavirus is actually RNA. That's the type of nucleic acid. RNA is very similar to DNA. So DNA is nucleic acid that we have in our cells. It's in the nucleus of our cells. And it's double-stranded. Not the best picture. It's two strands that are intertwined, double helix. Okay, this has all, in a chemical form, has all the information for our genes. This is what our genes are made out of, DNA. So normally, this DNA unravels to form two strands. Okay, then the RNA we have in our cells comes next to this strand and does a copy. Say, all right, this is the message you're telling me. I'm going to take this message that you're telling me, and I'm going to go and deliver this message, this genetic code, if you will. I'm going to go tell them to make the proteins that you're telling me to make them. So this messenger RNA, mRNA, is essentially a message like you send in a mail. And then it goes, and it's going to tell the other part of the cell to start making proteins. The exact kind of protein is dependent on the genetic code. So a new protein is made, a very specific protein, and more copies of the same protein can be made. And that's what happens. Some viruses have DNA and some viruses have just RNA. The coronavirus is RNA. And what it does is it actually gets into the cell and starts making proteins for itself, for its outer shell. Vaccines, up until this new vaccine for the coronavirus, vaccines have only been made in two different ways, essentially.
The first kind of vaccine is the live attenuated vaccine. For these types of vaccines, a weaker, asymptomatic form of the virus, or bacteria, but in this case we're talking about virus, is introduced into the body. Because it's weakened, the pathogen won't spread and cause sickness, but the immune system will still learn to recognize its antigens and know to fight it in the future. Because these vaccines introduce actual live pathogens into the body, it's an excellent stimulation for the immune system. So live attenuated vaccines can result in lifelong immunity with just one or two doses. But because they contain live pathogens, these live attenuated vaccines aren't given to people with weakened immune systems, such as people undergoing chemotherapy or HIV treatment. And there is a risk that the pathogen could get stronger by mutation and cause sickness, although that's pretty rare. For inactivated vaccines, these have a specific virus or bacteria, but in this case, virus that we're talking about, that is killed with heat or chemicals, and its dead cells are introduced into the body. So think of it as like the virus's dead body. Even though the pathogen is dead, the immune system can still learn from its antigens how to fight live versions of it in the future. These vaccines can be freeze-dried and easily stored because there's no risk of killing the pathogen as there is with the live vaccines. They're also safer without the risk of the virus or bacteria mutating back into its disease-causing form. Because the virus is dead, it's not as effective as a live vaccine. Therefore, it often takes several doses and booster shots to train the body to defend itself.
Now, with this new coronavirus vaccination, totally groundbreaking, instead of doing either of these two, what they're doing is they stole, I don't want to say steal, but they got the genetic code from the Chinese. Okay, they got the mRNA. They are able to figure out the exact RNA of the virus. And they're taking that genetic code and they're saying, you know what? That's going to be our vaccine. We're going to inject that into the body, and then the immune system, with its different lymphocytes, they're going to recognize this RNA, and then they're going to incorporate that into their own cells, and they're going to start making proteins. Okay, they're going to start making proteins of that virus, and the body's going to recognize the protein and say, listen, this is not a good protein for us. We have to attack that protein and destroy it. And the next time we see this virus come around knocking, we're going to kill it. So that's what happens. The only problem with this is we don't know how safe this is, and we don't know how effective it is because it's never been done before. So that's why we need clinical trials before we just start giving this to people. So those clinical trials will probably take a year, starting from when they start getting the vaccine. So if it's going to start in April, probably realistically speaking, it would be April to May of 2021 before this vaccine is ready. Another common question is, how long does this virus last on surfaces? You know, there's studies being done on this right now, and I plan on making a video dedicated towards that topic, either, if not in the next one, probably the one after that. Another question I was asked was based on intubation, because when I did a video on analyzing the autopsy results of the patient who died from COVID-19, I was describing in that video how the patient actually refused to be intubated. And a lot of the questions were, what is it like to be intubated? Are they sedated? Are they unconscious for it? So when we put a breathing tube in someone, meaning we do an endotracheal intubation, we just about always give sedation. Less commonly, anesthesiologists will do awake intubations in which they still give some sedation, but not to the point that renders them unconscious. Also, these patients get a lidocaine spray to numb the back of the throat. In emergency situations, like during a cardiac arrest, we don't use any sedation at all because the heart's not pumping and they're not conscious. So there's no need to give them sedation. A lot of people are asking, the patient in the autopsy result video, was he a smoker? In that study, they didn't mention if he was a smoker or not, so I don't know. And a lot of people are asking, does smoking put your increased risk for coronavirus disease? Well, the official answer is we don't know because there haven't been any studies done on it, but I think we could presume that it would put someone at slightly higher risk of getting a respiratory illness in general. Of course, you should not be smoking anyway. It's bad for you. If you want to talk about having your immune system at full capacity, you need to not be smoking. You need to be eating healthy, exercising, getting good sleep. These are all factors that will help you have your immune system running at full capacity. Another question is, can you get reinfected with the virus? There are some reports out there that some patients have been reinfected. I think this is pretty rare, and I think this is more the exception than the rule. I think it's more of an outlier because they probably got reinfected in the window between the time they're infected and the time that their immune system developed antibodies. Our immune system develops several different kinds of antibodies, but when we get infected, the first ones from a new infection are called IgM, and they take about a week to develop, and then they have that spike about 1 week, and then they start to fade away 1 week later. Another antibody we have is called IgG, and this takes a little bit longer to develop when someone gets infected. So I think probably what happened is the few patients that are getting reinfected, they probably got the virus, and they probably caught the virus a second time before their bodies had time to make these antibodies in response to the virus. Speaking of antibodies, the IgM and the IgG antibodies can actually be useful in helping make the diagnosis. So if there's a limited amount of PCR tests available, a good alternative would be to test patient's serology to look at the IgG and the IgM serology and see if they are positive for the coronavirus disease. The only problem, again, because this is also new, it takes time to develop these tests and for every hospital to have this test available in their lab. What about giving plasma from infected patients who recovered to patients who have the disease? So the thought process with this is when we get infection, we have antibodies. Now the idea is if that person survives, if they're better, can we take the antibodies that that patient developed and just like we do blood draws, we draw their blood and then we spin it down and we isolate the plasma from their blood. Then we take that plasma that contains the antibodies to the virus and then we transfuse that into someone else. I don't know how much this is being done in China. There are reports of that going on. Either way, it needs to be studied. One, because we need to know if it actually works. And two, because we have to know how safe it is. Generally speaking, whenever we give a patient fresh frozen plasma, we have to weigh the pros and cons. Some of those cons include the risk of allergic reaction and the risk of TRALI, transfusion-related acute lung injury. FFP is actually particularly prone to causing TRALI. Also, FFP is a valuable commodity. It comes from donated blood. So that's another reason why we have to be selective in who we give it to. So I'm going to wrap up this video. I know there's more questions that I didn't get to, but I'll try to in the upcoming videos. The biggest takeaway from this one is to be prepared as you can. And as an individual, the best thing that you can do is just focus, be mindful of hand hygiene, do your best to wash your hands appropriately, wash them effectively, and do not touch your face without having clean hands. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next one.